May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be as pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Please take a seat. I want to start this morning's sermon with two stories. One is set at, let's say, Cambridge University. It's a fictional story. And there's a bunch of professors at the end of the year from various different faculties, and they've got together and they're having a sit down for Christmas drinks. And one of them, who's a physics professor, says, "Do you know that this year I made an amazing breakthrough?" And they all are very impressed. They said, "Ooh, tell us about it." He said, "Well, what I did is I invented a device that allows me to reach back in time and get a person from history and bring them forward to our time." Everyone was stunned. And the man said, "Have you tested it?" And he said, "Yes. I've brought a number of people from the past to our time and then sent them back to their time. And what was it like?" And the professor said, "It was actually a great disappointment, because most, well, as a physics professor, the first thing I did is I brought forward some great scientists. And they saw the world, and they just did not have the mental flexibility to cope with the adjustments that we've made." And all the other professors nodded wisely, because they're professors. And eventually they started to say, well, did you eventually think of maybe bringing someone who had demonstrated in their own life much greater mental flexibility?" And the physics professor said, "Yes, I did. I thought, who is a great thinker, a person who's able to empathize with many different people, and I brought forward Shakespeare. And he loves our modern world, and in fact, he enrolled at the university." And the English professor is, "Oh, was he in one of my classes?" And the physics professor says, "Yes, you failed him." I love that story, because there's a person who found a great deal of difficulty with analyzing poetry. I always wondered if, when we were doing the analyzing, did we go too deep? Did we go down the rabbit hole that shouldn't have been there in the first place? So, that's one story. The other story is, I'm told, more historically accurate. It certainly doesn't involve time-traveling people, so it's got a chance. The story is of a young princess, if you will, wealthy, noble family, from Constantinople. And she is coming to the Holy Land to do her tour. And she's on the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. And she comes to a spot where there is mountains, rocks, looks a bit dangerous. And she says, "This must be the spot where the Samaritan found the beaten Jewish man and helped him up. We should build a chapel here." And so her retinue built a chapel, because that's what she told them to do. And the problem with that story, of course, is Jesus, that wasn't a real story in history. There wasn't actually a man who got, well, there probably were, because it's a dangerous road. But when Jesus was telling that story, he wasn't recounting a particular historical event. Sometimes the story is just the story. And the point of that story is, who is my neighbor? Which brings me to today's parable that Jesus told about the 10 virgins. And it's a tough one, actually. Now, let's just assume that we take it at face value. Face value, Jesus is recounting something of a wedding tradition there. There are young girls, and they're about 12 or 13 at this age, roughly. Not quite old enough to be married, but they're no longer children. They're in that category. For them, pretty young. And the tradition is that they will wait for the bridegroom to come, and they're friends of the bride's. And Jesus is telling this story, trying to get people to understand how important it is to live a life that is prepared. And many people interpret this as being prepared for the second coming. You know, Jesus coming again. But I suspect that it's more personal than that. live a life where when God asks something of us, we are in a position to say yes. We've made that decision already, and when God asks of us, we will know the answer. We have said yes already. So that's sort of at the first level, if you will. And there's value in that. There's great value. But if we drill just a little deeper, we get to this interesting notion: why could those five young women not share their oil with the five who hadn't bought spare? Now, there's no physical reason for that if you assume that this is an actual historical story. The bridegroom's literally coming over the hill. They're about to go in. You're not going to run out of oil in 2 or 3 minutes. What's Jesus talking about? Possibly he's talking about something that often frustrated me when I was working as a school chaplain. Because you have this conversation with people, tell me about where you're at with God and the church. And the answer was almost invariably, when I was a child, it's nice, you're in your 50s now, or my parents go to the Anglican Church. Well, isn't that interesting? What they want to do is they want to borrow faith from their parents or from their childhood. And you can't. You can't get by on borrowed faith. You can't borrow somebody else's faith to answer these questions and challenges in life. And that might be why. No matter how much those five who had come prepared might have wanted to, you can't borrow my faith. I can share what I know, my understanding of God, but at the end of the day, it's yours. It's just like you can't borrow a friendship from someone. You might be introduced to a good person, but you can't borrow a friendship. And that's worth our contemplating as well. Let's drill a little deeper. A little deeper. I have difficulty with this parable if we just have a look at it at a face value, because what it does is it says those who aren't appropriately prepared get shut out. And that's a problem. That's a problem for me when I say, no, the church and God is about welcoming all. Whether you're prepared or not prepared, God is loving and welcoming. So, I wonder if there isn't something in the character and nature of God that is in fact described by these 10 young girls. We would think of them as girls. They're 12 or 13 years old. If their character doesn't describe something of the nature of God, who says, whether or not this activity will succeed, it is worth doing. I don't believe that God buys into the standard modern economic model of whether or not things are worth doing. I don't believe God sits down and does a risk-benefit analysis before God acts. God acts because it is the good and loving thing to do, and it might be ridiculously foolish. But it is loving. It is the act that doesn't necessarily count the cost, that doesn't think about whether or not this will make sense when described in an economics textbook in 2,000 years. That's a profoundly significant picture of God that says perhaps the world will shut God out because it doesn't recognize the value of a heart that said yes. So let's take those three lessons from this parable. Let's recommit ourselves to living prepared so that we know the answer when God says to us, will you be this way? We've decided the answer is yes. Let's recommit ourselves to having our own faith, to being generous with our knowledge and wisdom and understanding and our quirky ideas and whatever it is, but we need to work on our own faith, our own relationship with God. Because it may well be that God asks us to be foolish in love, but it's worth it. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.